Hey gang, welcome to the October 2012 episode of VMTV. I'm John, and holy crap, look who's here, it's Rob!
I know, I love that long-haired Jesus guy. No, it's me, hi, the new and improved Rob. Now with riboflavin. We got an exciting show, we promise you today. We got some really cool reviews, and maybe a surprise or two.
Yeah, in fact, one of our surprises is en route to the studio here. Believe me, guys, there's more entertainment to be found here today than in watching Hayden Panettiere's side boob.
Well, while we wait for said surprise to get here, let's check out some of the cheats. Come on, everybody. Join us.
Won't you?
Hayden Panettiere's side boob?
I don't know. It just popped in there.
I mean, really, John, you couldn't think of anything else?
I try to think of the most harmless thing.
Okay, let me get this straight. So what you're telling me, John, is this is the segment that 10% of our viewers can do without?
Uh-huh. Well, look, sometimes it helps to have these cheats performed to make sure that they're accurate. We're just providing a friendly service to you guys out there. That's all. So, gang, what we have here is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2, the arcade game for the NES, all booted up and ready to go. Today we're going to show you how to not only select your starting level, but also give you 10 extra lives, or turtles in this case. Take this controller, if you will. Let's get underway.
Thank you, sir. When you begin at your title screen, take your controller and do the following sequence. B, A, B, A. Up, down, B, A. Left, right, B, A. Start. Now make sure to do this quickly before the demonstration kicks in.
And if you did it quickly and correctly enough, you'll be taken to a screen where you can select not only your starting level, but you'll get those 10 extra lives all in reserve. Not bad, huh? Guys, you're all set to go.
All right, shall we go? I mean, can we leap out of here?
Well, Ziggy says there's an 88% chance that there's a particular way to wrap up this segment and leap out of here.
Well, Dean Stockwell, how do you suggest we... Oh, no, you're not suggesting that.
You better believe it, Skippy. Come on, let's do it for the kids.
Cowabunga! Promise me we never have to do that again.
I make no promises.
Well, we should be landing on Earth in a few minutes. Maybe I should find something to pass the time other than looking at Hayden Panettiere's side boob. Hey Duke, can you run some sort of clip from your data banks while I make some last minute preparations?
Of course, Earl. I am a supercomputer, am I not? One moment, if you please.
Alright gang, for years I've tried to point you in the right direction when it comes to emulating classic consoles or handhelds. With little to no success. It's not my fault! What are you gonna do, shoot me? You missed. You have terrible aim. Guys, this is the reason I'm at Stephanie's house, fellow video master and someone who just tried an attempted murder. Because she claims that she has a little something that can put all those faulty, shitty clones that I reviewed in the past to shame. Steph, they say the fourth time's a charm. No, they don't. What have you got for us?
Okay, we have the Atari Flashback 2, made 2005, and this is actually from Atari, and it is almost like a full-size Atari original 2600, shrunken down, miniaturized, with wood grain and everything. And inside, unlike some other clones of systems out there, this actually is an Atari on a chip. So you're going to get as close to the original versions as you possibly can.
Without a prescription from your doctor. Well, I'm not seeing a cartridge port on this thing, so the games are built in?
There are 40 games built in.
Ah, 40. This many.
And I'm good at all of them.
Well, we'll see about that. Grab your controller and let's get busy.
Do it.
So we're going to show you exactly what the Flashback 2 has in store for you right now.
This Atari Flashback model is the only model to feature an Atari on the chip. which means that you're going to get the most authentic 2600 experience possible. Some of the 40 built-in games include Asteroids, Pitfall, Centipede, Yars' Revenge, Adventure, Missile Command, Combat, and Pong. Of course, they also include some homebrew titles, such as Asteroids Deluxe, Adventure 2, Return to Haunted House, and many more. There are two joysticks that come bundled with the Flashback 2, so that means you can get in some two-player action. However, the choices of games are not so great, so you may end up playing with yourself. Even though there are currently four Flashback models available, this is the only one that can be modded with an Atari cartridge port, which means that you can play 90% of the original Atari carts, with minor exceptions. Despite a few of the issues on some of the games, the sound on the built-in games does sound like what you would hear if you played the games on an original 2600 hardware. Both the homebrew games and the original Atari titles play on-screen very well on any TV.
Oh, that's great. So now for the verdict, is this machine worth buying, and more importantly, is it worth modding just to play the extra games?
Yes and no.
Okay.
For the Atari purist, I recommend that you search for an original 2600. For the time and effort you're going to put into modding a Flashback 2, you're better off picking up the original and modding that to be composite output.
Yeah, so just to let you know, we're not across the board bashing this particular unit. We do feel it's a step in the right direction. The sound is reproduced really well, so that's going to be something even the purist will dig. So overall, if you want to spend the money to get a Flashback 2, don't let us hold you back. However, if you really want to have an authentic Atari experience, go on an auction site, Game Gavel, eBay, what have you, Craigslist if you want, and invest the extra money, if it is, to pick up an original 2600 with a couple of games. We think you'll like it.
And oh my god, it is so small and cute.
Fits right in your pocket. We'll see you guys later. Known for its numerous awards, including a Guinness World Record, you'll take control of the Dark Knight himself. No. No. Aw, hell no. There we go. You'll begin the game taking the Joker to Arkham Asylum, where all the other Bat supervillains and crazies reside. Beginning the game victorious already? Oh, if only that were true, gang. Once the Clown Prince of Crime is brought further into the asylum, he and his cohort, Harley Quinn, put a takeover plan into effect. That's right, looks like Joker wanted to be put in the asylum so he can run it, as well as the inmates, which include a few of Batman's greatest arch foes, like Bane, Killer Croc, Poison Ivy, and Scarecrow, and they look awesome! Now, I realize many of you game players know the plot already, you've mastered the game, and have already traded it into your local GameStop for a third of what you paid for it. Just keep in mind that we do have other viewers watching who may not have experienced this third-person perspective title yet, and they may be curious about what the game has in store for them. Basically, in order to succeed in this game, you must make your way around the island prison, defeating the various henchmen and major villains, and taking down the Joker. The game equips you with different abilities for the Caped Crusader. In addition to your typical running and jumping, you'll also utilize stealth here. This is essential in many parts of the game for taking down the Joker's goons silently without attracting attention. While that may sound tedious if you're in a room trying to sneak up on several different bad guys, it certainly is rewarding when you execute that silent takedown on an armed thug, as opposed to being impatient and just casually charging at them, only to be filled with lead. A lot of times, in order to pull off successful takedowns like this, you can toggle on and off what's known as detective mode. This switches to a cool X-ray style mode where you can see henchmen behind objects and other important things that Batman can interact with in some form. You'll discover all this and more as you play,
and you'll obtain a couple of sweet gadgets and effective fighting tactics that won't harm innocent bystanders in the asylum. As you clear the asylum of enemies, you can build up experience points. Now, this means that you can make upgrades or enhancements to Batman's weapons, his suit, and much more. Another way to accumulate points is by solving puzzles scattered around the island, left by none other than the Riddler. Alright, I think I've given you folks a good idea of what Batman Arkham Asylum is all about and what you can do. Let's talk about the graphics first. For a guy who has played more classic games than modern, I found the graphics to be amazing, top-notch material. The developers over at Rocksteady really took great care in making sure that you are Batman. You move around like him and can perform fantastic combo attacks smoothly without worrying about glitches that would have ruined the experience. The cinema cutscenes featured throughout play are phenomenal and help tell the story with great visuals. The sound? Well, while there aren't countless music tracks to accompany this game, it's not a requirement, especially when you're sneaking around and just doing some basic exploration. When the music does kick in, ooh baby, is it cool. It complements the sound effects well, and where would a Batman game be without hearing some vocal talent? Well, you Batman aficionados are in for a real treat if you haven't played this entry in the series yet. Kevin Conroy, who supplied the voice for Batman in the various animated TV and films spanning back to the early 90s until today, returns to voice the Dark Knight again.
Every plant on this island will get the same unless you cooperate.
He surrendered almost without a fight. I don't like it.
As one would expect, Conroy does a wonderful job. Even though it can be a bit odd to hear Batman's thoughts, you have to remember that this is meant to help you get somewhere in the game. Moving on, Mark Hamill returns to voice the Joker. Naturally, he does not disappoint. He delivers with funny lines and that memorable laugh that many of us remember from the classic animated series.
Too easy. Played you like a violin and cut your strings.
Nighty-night, Bats.
There are also a few other notable actors like Steve Bloom, Tom Kane, Fred Tatasciore, and many more lending their voices and all doing a perfect job here. Now, I'm playing this game on my PS3, and the controls certainly agree with me. I didn't have to tweak any options before playing, and it's easy to move Batman around, perform his moves. Once in a while, I would hit the wrong button or zigged when I should have zagged, but we're all gonna play this game differently. In any case, the young and older game players can most likely pick the game up and not be intimidated by the controls. When it comes to a challenge, though, that's a whole other animal. Even though I completed the game inside of a week or so, I found myself replaying the same scenes 20 or 30 times before I actually succeeded. Some of you may do better than others, and even if you bring the Joker to justice, there are still other challenges for you to take up and many secrets to uncover around Arkham Island. That's right, I said I finished the game, but I'm still finding more of the Riddler's puzzles and playing the other modes that the game has to offer. The downside to this is while you're on the island searching for whatever secrets you missed, there are no enemies for you to fight. It's as quiet as a tomb, plus I wasn't able to replay the final boss stage whenever I wanted, which is a shame and kind of lowers the game's replay value. Despite having a negative aspect here and there, I had a great time playing Batman Arkham Asylum. For many of you, revisiting this game world and trying the harder difficulties and other challenges is certainly worthy of your time. The game did let me down with the replay, like I said earlier, but I have no intention of parting with this game or trading it in somewhere so I can buy a bottle of water. So, I'm gonna keep this one. Batman will be proud.
Hey there, digital diggers! The order of the day this month is stop-motion animation with a side order of updated old-school, new-school scroll gaming. We have some fun entries in the dig, so let's get to it.
Our first short is only 1 minute and 43 seconds, but this must have taken weeks, or at least a few sleepless days and nights exercising their obsessive-compulsive disorder. We have NES stop motion, done in plastic hammer beads. This was a most impressive display of NES favorites, inhabiting about a 1 foot by 1 foot square that takes us on a simple character-driven journey with Super Mario, Mega Man, Zelda, and even a keyboard to start it all. Very well done. Patience is indeed a virtue, and it also takes an ass load of time. This entry is a look into a traditional animated computer gaming adventure opus and a nice anniversary homage to the old Atari Pitfall games we grew up with. Believe it or not, it's been 30 years, and now on iTunes for 99 cents for the iPad and the iPhone, it has a pretty cool advancement in the graphics department and is essentially an endless running, avoidance, sliding, jumping along the lines of the app game Temple Run. But unlike the 2600 days of old, the scrolling game track, this isn't too prevalent because of the upgraded technology, but after a while you may have a fleeting desire to bash your head in with monotony. However, with the nifty effects and decent play, I do still love me some Pitfall. It takes me back, and forward, and jumping, and swinging, and sliding, and collecting at a blistering pace, and is a pretty cool looking Activision classic game reinterpretation. Give me a brown fedora and a whip. Hey, that's kinda kinky. And there's almost always one clunker of the bunch. Inasmuch as I applaud the effort to really want Spider-Man live action in 1969, after the animated series became such a hit, this one truly sucks Aunt May's walking gain. Made in toto by Donald Glut, film school buddy of George Lucas, and the gentleman who would later be responsible for penning the Empire Strikes Back authorized novel of the film by Lucasfilm Uber Marketing Franchise-orama, I guess Lucas felt bad and decided to give his friend, nay, auteur never-to-be Mr. Glut, a writing gig after this stink burger failed to attract a buyer. One can only wonder that you're not too freaking surprised. This stinker has it all. Bad acting, bad script, bad costumes, bad acting, and bad stop-motion animation that pains itself in trying to mesh between live-action and stop-motion animation. They tried at least, but did I mention bad acting? Can't stress that enough. There are two good things I could discern that wasn't too painful: the web effects, and it had the conceptual distinction of never being tried before. Yeah, they made an effort, but you see, up until that point, no one dared attempt to make an effort to do the Spider-Man live under penalty of humiliation and copious amounts of scofflawing and French taunting. But these guys dared. Boy, did they ever. You know the old train wreck philosophy of media? Watch it for that reason. Then you'll likely make it through without wanting to typically say, "Well, that's 11 minutes I'll never get back." Now, what's going to save us from the previous stop-motion misfire and knock your damnable socks off? Batman: Dark Nightfall. This is how stop-motion animation is done. Taking the story-esque elements of The Dark Knight and The Dark Knight Rises, these guys have done a stop-motion animation style that stays action figure traditional, but adds action elements I haven't seen before in this genre or any other, but I want to see more of. Creators Derek Kwok and Henry Wong at Parabucks have given some realism, in which the very cool Hot Toys figurines can take a good deal of the credit, and purpose of action, in almost a Aardman Burton-esque kind of way. Just enjoy the ride. I don't need to say more about this total fan-made stop-motion winner, and I personally enjoyed having Bane and both movie Jokers in this one. Nice. We're going to keep our eyes out for these guys and hopefully bring you some follow-up action figure sequels. That's the dig, true believers. This is your friendly neighborhood VMTV host Rob, aping the catchphrase, "Nuff said."
Hi there, humans. Elder Robot here. We're going to steer away from TV robots this month, and instead we're going to look at a classic animated TV show, one that was originally a Japanese anime series, but was adapted for American television in 1978. The original dates back to 1972 and was called Science Ninja Team Gatchaman, of which 105 episodes were made. But you'll know it by its American title, Battle of the Planets. Produced by Sandy Frank Entertainment, the 85 episodes in the American series stayed pretty faithful to the plot and character developments of the original, but some parts of it were Americanized to suit the new US TV audience. Mostly the omissions were the elements of violence, profanity, and even some transgenderism. But there was a later US readaptation of Gatchaman done in 1986 called G-Force, Guardians of Space, which had quite a lot of the original ideas and content included. The premise of Battle of the Planets revolves around five young orphans who together make up the organization G-Force. And G-Force protect the good guys, Planet Earth, from the bad guys, Planet Spectra and beyond. And in particular, the field commander of the Spectra forces, Zoltar, who takes his orders from a mysterious leader known only as the Luminous One. The five characters are Mark, who is the leader, Jason, who is usually grumpy, Princess, who is the only female character in G-Force, Keop, who is the youngest, and Tiny, who is the junior member of the team. G-Force have a spacecraft called the Phoenix, which has four other smaller vehicles that detach from it, and which members of the G-Force team use when the need arises, which, as you can guess, it frequently does. The four vehicles are a futuristic car with hidden weapons and driven by Jason, a motorcycle ridden by Princess, an all-terrainian and submersible tank with vertical takeoff and landing driven by Keop, and a jet fighter flown by Mark. Tiny doesn't have a craft and pilots a Phoenix, which also has an ace up its sleeve. It can transform into a flaming bird-shaped craft, hence the name Phoenix, which can get it out of a lot of scrapes. In typical Japanese fashion, the G-Force team members use a combination of martial arts, ninja-like weapons, and what are known as cerebronic powers to defeat their enemies, and the costumes give them a bird-like appearance, and at times they allow them to drift and glide through the air, though not fly exactly. Mark's uniform is that of an eagle, Jason's is a condor, Princess has a swan, Keop has a swallow, and Tiny has an owl. The weapons range from a sonic boomerang and a bird-shaped boomerang to gadget guns and explosives, and they all have a wrist-based communicator, which doubles up as a tool to switch between the G-Force costumes and civilian clothes. One of the most memorable characters in the show for me was Keop, because he has a very unusual way of speaking and would stutter a lot, while also making strange sounds as he spoke, and often beginning sentences with a series of beeps and whistles. The explanation for that is that he's an artificial life form who was created, and his speech impediment is caused by a glitch in his genetic engineering. So, just how sanitized was the US version then? What was in Gatchaman that wasn't in Battle of the Planets? Well, firstly, the profanity. Not that it was heavily used in the original, but don't forget this was meant to appeal to American children and keep their parents happy too. The graphical violence was also missing, and there's a clear aversion to violence in American kids' shows of this era. Just look at the A-Team, for example. For all the thousands of rounds fired in every episode, not one person's shot and killed. There's no blood. And these are supposed to be the best that the US military has got to offer. But on this show, they come to hit a cow's arse with a banjo. Battle of the Planets would often go out of its way to show the audience that a city has been evacuated before you see it being destroyed. Or when you see a planet's armies and air forces being destroyed, it's made quite clear that these are robot armies rather than humans or living aliens. More interestingly though is the transgenderism that was cut from Battle of the Planets, or actually, that it was included in Gatchaman to begin with. The main villain, Zoltar, is based on the character Berg Katze, who is a hermaphrodite, which caused a problem when adapting one episode in particular, The Galaxy Girls, which features both sides of Katze's character. So the US show had to introduce a separate character to get around it. But they did hint at the origin of the character by naming her Marla Latourose, an anagram of Zoltar. It was also necessary to create another character in the US version too, an android named Seven Zark Seven, who would narrate segments of the story that needed explaining or explaining away more often. He also provided some light comic relief to fill time where violent bits had been cut from the original animation. Trying to cash in on the back of the popularity of Star Wars, Seven's Arc 7 looked quite similar to R2-D2 and acted somewhat similarly to C-3PO. His role in the show's story was to man the underwater center Neptune, which was a base from which he could detect threats to Earth and relay that information to the G-Force team aboard the Phoenix. To keep him company, he had a robotic dog called One Rover One, who could fly short distances by using his tail as a propeller. Battle of the Planets was also released in comic book form, originally by Gold Key Comics and later by Top Cow Productions. And there was a Battle of the Planets comic strip in the British TV comic, The TV Comic, which ran some of the Top Cow and later some of the Gold Key stories. I think that anime purists will much prefer the original Gatchaman series, but there's a lot to like about Battle of the Planets, and if you've never seen the original, then you won't see it as being a somewhat sanitised experience, because the storylines and the plots and the character developments mirror those of the original almost exactly.
Radar has picked up a suspicious aircraft in your vicinity. It's headed north.
So, is it worth you tracking down the show? Well, with it being available on DVD, it absolutely is worth you tracking down, and it will immediately have a familiar sound to it. If for no other reason, then it's sounding a little like a Scooby-Doo cartoon, with the voice of Mark being done by Casey Kasem. So, until next time, intergalactic cross-dressers, this is Earl, the masculine robot, saying bollocks, and goodbye.
Well, gang, thanks so much for joining us this month. Thanks for watching, and especially thanks to Earl. Thank you so much for those photos and for the crumb cake. How did you know? That was so good. It was delicious.
No problem at all. I hope my gift will serve you humans well. For you other inferior beings out there, don't forget to visit our website at www.videomasterstv.com.
Well, we're going to let you hit that old dusty trail. I know John has some stuff for you, so I'm going to take off, eh? You know, but we hope you come back again soon and meet some more of the gang, like Stephanie here.
Don't hold your breath, kid.
Nice. Way to break his spirit, John.
She'll break his heart, man. What else was I to do?
It's okay, Earl. Maybe this will make you feel better.
Stephanie.
Oh, Stephanie.